Well, good afternoon. I don't know how you are doing, but you know, I'm overwhelmed with information and ideas. And then at the end of the day, that's what can you add? So what I want to add is a perspective. I'm an optimist. I think that we are talking about the creation of a new industry, and I'll come back to that. The first 3 years, we're always too optimistic, and the last 3 years, we're too pessimistic. And I think we are somewhere in the middle. So what I want to do with you is go through some technology, what I think is going to be a key enabler. The technology is not the solution. And let me say that again and again and again. It's a tool, it's an enabler. We are the solution. We have to make it work. And I really want to give a compliment to the organizers of this conference with the quality of the discussions, the depth, but also the facilitation. I think they do a fantastic job for us. What are the challenges we need to address from a social point of view? And I have just tried to give some elements that I think we can attack by enablement of technology. I've divided it, as you can see, in the developed world and in the emerging countries. And what you will see is there are a lot of similarities. But I lived the last 5 years in India, in Bangalore, and I've learned a lot. When I came there, the Minister of Commerce, Kamal Nath, he said to me, Wim, you probably have an MBA. Yes, you have to unlearn. You have to completely start thinking different. Don't try to sell what you have. Let's create what we need. That is one of those first things that's in my brain. My top 10 of problem statements that I would have had in California changed dramatically, and I got a complete different agenda. But if you look at it, the emerging countries, if you said about it, 700 million people will be urbanized. That's 180,000 today. There is a need for 100 new cities with 1 million people. I am not an urban planner, but I'm still surprised that urban planners tell what doesn't work. I still haven't seen a plan how to urbanize. How are we going to build 100 new cities in a decade? We have not that answer yet. 50% of the new building and construction is in Asia, so you better be there, because that's where the innovation will come. And the Chinese master planning and urbanized planning. We look with our view and probably say, I don't know. But let's listen to them. Quite embarrassing, of course, is that 50% of the population in India and Africa does not even have access to healthcare and education. 3 billion people in the next decade are going to be connected to the internet. That means that people in rural areas will get access to information before they have access to water and electricity. And I dare to predict that the next Bill Gates will come out of the rural areas. Because technology will enable business models and innovation that we haven't heard of yet. And we have to dream a little bit on how that could be possible. And there is a shortage of 4 million teachers in India alone. 150 million people have to be trained. If you take the United Nations standards, and we talked about safety already, we will need an additional 600,000 police agents in India alone, if we do it in the traditional way. If you look into the developed world, I think revitalization has started, and we have already heard a lot of good stories. On the other hand, only 3% of buildings are LEED certified. And you know, that's astonishing. And that 70% of energy is used in cities, 70% in buildings, utilization is 40%. You know, why not a decrete like we did in San Francisco, that every new building has to be LEED certified? It's a political willness to get that done. If you look in the US, there's going to be an enormous mismatch with the demographic shifts, aging population, Europe aging and shrinking, and that there will be 2 million home care workers needed. There is already a shortage of 200,000 nurses, and the inequality is getting bigger in supply and demand of jobs. 1 million teachers are going to retire in the next decade. STEM, that's science, technology, engineering, and math, 4 out of the 10 are going to retire. And believe me, young people don't want to work in manufacturing. It's not cool. And the mayor of Chongqing, he said to me, Wim, you know, manufacturing back in the US, you guys walk on leather shoes. You're not going back in the factory. Accept that. And so we have to accept a complete mismatch. Crime rates are up. A lot of cities are doing a great job, but you know, I don't want to be the pessimist here. Crime rates are up. And 60% of city dwellers have been confronted with crime. And so if you take the commonalities between the two and you say, well, what can we address with technology, then I think the common themes are safety and security. And there will be a lot of discussions about privacy, but a lot of things will be trade-offs. I had the pleasure to work with Nandan Nilekani in India on give people a unique number. And there are a lot of, you know, positives and negatives. But if you give people an identity, that's a big thing. Access to healthcare and education. And that from a technology point of view, in emerging countries, that's for me always the first priority. The talent mismatch, supply and demand. Let's accept that there will be another wave of outsourcing. And I wouldn't call it outsourcing, I would call it right sourcing. We have to accept on the globe that the globe is going to be a global marketplace. And where will work be done is the supply and demand. If we are too protectionism, either to keep what we have or to not give or try to steal things back, maybe nowadays call it indigenous innovation, I call it protectionism. And then last but not least, from a technology point of view, energy management and urbanization. So we've heard this technology, that everything is going to be connected. We call it the Internet of Things, and it is happening. Everything will become horizontalized. We are at an inflection point at the moment. 37 billion devices will be connected. We will add 3 billion people to the internet. And my dream application is machine to machine, an alarm clock. That work comes to you nowadays. So when I'm here on a conference, I still work like you probably all do. And that work follows you. So this morning, alarm clock at 4 o'clock and conference call at 4:30. I phone in, meeting canceled. Why not connect it to my alarm? And people would have warned me. That's how I think with my Western type of mentality. And how we should think is that we can enable productivity, we can create new value, and things that are connected can be green and secure. This is how I look at a city. I'm not an urban planner, but the Internet of Things is around since 1998. And probably you will ask now, why now? Why is it now so important? I think it's because of cloud computing. We have new opportunities, and most important, and look at the tablets and the wireless type of communication. Work will fundamentally change, and there will be, you know, three kids in a rural area somewhere, either in India or in Indonesia, who will come up with an application for something, an application we haven't thought of. And let's not fool ourselves. You know, if I talk to my children, 13 and 16, and I talk about my youth, that I was 14 years old and we got a black and white television at home, they don't understand me. And there are no children here. We should get some people in from 14 and 16 years old and see how they work, live, work, and play. Totally different. Listen to them. I dare to say that most people above 40 are not innovative anymore. And of course, we are the exceptions. But think about it. We think in barriers. We think in imperatives. Study young people. And that's another shift. The young people are in the Middle East and India and Indonesia. Even China is already aging. And so how cities will look, and this is how we will start in the mature cities, we'll get integrated operation center, where everything comes together. This is Rio de Janeiro, and that we have a passionate mayor, and I love cities with a deadline. And they're going to get the Olympics, they have to get their act together. And so they are executing. Because a lot of things are not executed. On the other side, citizens will get access to services, either on their mobile, on their phone, on a tablet, on whatever type of device, I don't know yet. Let's dream a little bit. Big data becomes open data for citizens to use. We talk about analytics and gathering of data, but it's not about the data, it's about the information, the knowledge, and the wisdom. What if scenarios? That's the future. What are you going to do? Make the data available, and public sector has started that. And private sector has to start working together and do the same. And then young kids will develop applications on it. As simple as that. And that will be an inflection point, and that also is going to work in rural areas. I have to hurry up. These are services. I'm not going into detail, but these are things that we are experimenting in the developed world how to monetize that, how to pay for it. And that's that because people are not going to consume technology, they're going to consume services. And that should be the opening to think about what is happening. If you think about it in the world, at this moment, 100 movies a week, 250 books released, and we have 15,000 new apps every week. And these apps are platform independent. And there will be ones that will suddenly break through and give tremendous opportunity for innovation and business models we don't think about because we think in our isolated type of world. And so you already see that in the US, in Washington, New York, open data, and people start developing apps, enormous returns, and citizen services are improved. Barcelona, Stockholm, Hamburg, great examples of how revitalization is working and how people attract young talent. And because it's going to be about the balance between an economic, social, and environmental objective. And the three have to, you can live in a green city, but if you have no job, it's not fun. And we know that here in London, in some parts of neighborhoods, boroughs, we had more than 40% unemployment. With high crime rates. And I think London has done a fantastic job with the deadline of the Olympics to upgrade a lot of boroughs and now to build on that. We talked about smart working centers. It's a concept that's going to be globalized. And I think as a vision, think about how the world will become a global workplace. And we will virtualize work. And we will get it out. Already in rural areas in India, in villages, and perhaps you don't like it, but again, it's fact. People are doing surveillance, video surveillance, for retail stores in the UK and the US. Illiterate people looking in stores and pushing a button if something goes wrong. And they're very, very happy with that job. We probably would say it doesn't need the standards, but it is a clean job. It's a respectable job. India now, the first, project is not so well known. It's the biggest infrastructure project in the world. It's the Mumbai-Delhi corridor, 1,400 kilometers, 28 cities, and look at that. Cities to be industrial hotspots with world-class infrastructure and connectivity. Citizen services, it is in the master plan. I see still master planning where ICT is overlooked. Where people don't think about technology, because urban planners like to build iconic cities and iconic buildings, awfully not pragmatic. I'm not going this, but these are all projects, case studies. I would love to share them with you, where we also talked about how to pay for it. What is the monetization model? How can we get this done? And so a lot of documentation around that, but just to set it. And the benefits of sustainable communities, if you embrace that economic, social, and environmental balance, and that energy saving 30% easy, water 50%. Singapore is already water neutral. Crime rates down 20% if people are more happy. Traffic down by 30%. If we have a small app and you see that coming up for parking, that just solving parking problems, that saves 30% in traffic congestion. And did you know that an average citizen in Paris spends 4 years of his or her life finding a parking place? It really, you know, it's ridiculous. And it will create jobs. And now my point, specifically for emerging countries, we are cracking the code that we can deliver education for $3 per student per month. And we can deliver virtual healthcare, but 80% of doctors' calls don't need physical intervention anyway, for $3 per intervention. And that are price points that are going to work. India cracked the code to make telephony affordable. 900 million people have a cell phone. In the US and in Europe, we spend on average $50 a month on the phone. In India, $2.50. So if we are going to scale, and this is a project, this is a village we built with housing, but I wouldn't call this a house, but it is a house, and people are very happy with it. And that we have to think different. We created virtual healthcare, virtual education. And this is a model that if we get broadband, because we need it, that is the enabler, whether you like it or not. It's like if you want to do distribution, if you have no roads, it doesn't work. But we have now proof of concepts that we can monetize, that we can scale, or that we can spread. And I'm quite optimistic with the right political will that we solve it. And we have documented this. There are now stores in these villages. There's an economic cycle going. People go to the classroom in the evening. In China, that after the terrible earthquake in the province of Chongqing, that we have done remote healthcare. And China has now a five-year plan to give healthcare to 98% of the population at affordable costs. So my closing slide, and this is a call to action to all of us. We talk about the creation of a new industry, and we have to step out of the box. We need visionary leadership, and we have that. But we also need global open standards. Otherwise, we can't make it affordable. Prices will come down, and things will be affordable if we standardize. We need smart regulation, policies. A lot has already been said. If you're water neutral and you have to have a water tank in the ground, like the policy in Australia, there goes your benefits. And we have to come up with building codes. We have to create public-private partnerships. And we could have a session around that. And then last but not least, we have to work together. We need new ecosystems. And that there is no company in the world who can do this alone. And we have to team up. And if we want to make it happen, we can make it happen. Thank you very much.